Charlie?
No, Dad.
Then you see it, Mother.
See what, Allie?
Why, a beautiful house. Right in front of you.
Greenest in the house.
This'll do for the kitchen. That could be the laundry and wash house. Tie the whole thing together with a platform and put the sleeping quarters up above. It's like the hub of a wheel, with the crops radiating out. I smell a bit of a swamp back there. We'll have to drain that.
Harrison Ford plays an American inventor who is sour on his country, and so he takes his wife and children to a primitive island in the Mosquito Coast. It's Harrison Ford's first film since his big hit Witness, and the Mosquito Coast, another serious picture, is one of the new movies we'll be reviewing this week. I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune.
And I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times. The Mosquito Coast is the movie that tells the story of one man's vision and how that vision ultimately turns destructive for himself and his family. Harrison Ford's character seems ordinary enough at the beginning of the movie when he's a Harvard dropout who thinks there's a lot wrong with America and he wants to get closer to the land. But then his obsession grows and grows, and eventually he moves his whole family, lock, stock, and barrel, to a third world jungle where he thinks they can become totally self-supporting because he thinks there's going to be a World War III. But after their little village is destroyed, a madness grows within him, and in this scene he drags his family along despite the fact that they're all developing some very real fears and doubts.
We could take that Pipanto up the coast to Mosquitia.
We could walk down the beach to Panama.
Or we could walk up the beach to Cape Cod.
Yes! Yes! Let's go to Cape Cod!
Yes! Let's go to Cape Cod! Yes!
No! No! We cannot go back.
Why?
Because it's not there anymore. America's not there anymore.
A little later, a hurricane pushes the whole family upstream, and after they think Harrison Ford is drowned, they try to figure out what they're going to do next.
Dad!
I can't stand this!
We'll be all right. We'll be all right.
I can't.
We'll be
I can't.
All right.
Stop.
We'll be all right.
Oh, baby.
We can go downstream and find Mr. Hattie.
Mom, Jerry's right. Let's go. Turn around.
Wait, let's get out of here.
Traitors.
That's Helen Mirren as the wife and mother there. Everybody calls her mother, and one of the movie's mysteries is how she remains so unshakable in the face of her husband's manic behavior. I kept waiting for her to be more concerned about her children. The Mosquito Coast is a very hard movie to like. I could appreciate the good acting here, and I could admire the way that Harrison Ford allowed his character's insanity to take over, and I was also impressed by the way the director, Peter Weir, used the forces of nature as a mystic counterpoint to the big plans of this strange man. But I was unable to go along with the movie's vision because it was so clear that this man was not a visionary, not a mystic, not a saint, but just simply nuttier than a fruitcake. Somebody should have blown the whistle on him. I suppose the movie is supposed to be a rite of passage in which the family's oldest son learns to be a man, but the son is not made important enough throughout the movie to make that work, and the hero's bizarre behavior kept us outside looking in.
And I found myself inside with him because in the beginning I didn't think he was nuttier than a fruitcake. And I think that's a little rough on this character. Here is a guy who seriously thinks there are problems in the land, and there are, he says them in a very bold way, that there's lawlessness and all this, things that a lot of people feel, and he wants to do something about it. His children worship him. He's an inventor. His wife, why does she go along? She adores him. They adore this guy. And I think that the movie made me wonder what was going to happen. I thought, he's making some sense. Yes, he's taking it to the extreme, but it reminded me of that 60s kind of notion of making a better world, and so I followed him up until a point in which he goes too far, and then logically,
yeah, well,
there's
Gene,
a switch.
The problem is, you're talking about the first 15 or 20 minutes of this
oh,
movie.
Oh, no, I was going with it for an
film,
hour.
He's dragging that family around in the jungle. He's putting them on a beach where,
yes,
everybody says the tide is going to come in, it's going to wash you all away, you won't even listen to them. He's clearly mad. And because
point,
he's mad, we no longer can take seriously anything that he's saying about this society, his family,
yeah,
or his plans.
But Roger,
he goes right over the edge.
He goes right over the edge. But when you're talking about on that island, you're talking about, oh, probably an hour and a half into the movie, not 15 minutes into the movie. This movie is quite compelling in showing that descent into madness,
well,
out of good intentions.
Your standards for rational behavior are more flexible than mine. But apart from that, how about the movie itself? Did,
yeah,
you really? Could you tell me what it was about?
Yes.
No, it's very hard to say what this
I'll tell
movie
you,
is about.
The movie is about how noble wishes and noble desires can get misled.
How about it's about how somebody goes nuts and his family has to be dragged along while he fulfills some.
If you don't like the movie, if you don't like the movie, that's what you think it's
okay,
about.
Did you
and
think
I like
it. Did it move fast for you?
Enjoyed it, and I thought the acting was great. And I thought again the use of nature, as you said, by the director. All the things that you liked about the movie, I liked too.
Okay, well that's great.
Okay, our next film is Streets of Gold, a Rocky-like boxing story, but this time the hero is not the boxer. It's the coach of all the boxers. It's the coach of all the boxers who's a Russian immigrant, and he's come to the United States because from Russia he was not allowed to fight because he was Jewish. So he comes to the United States and he finds a couple of street fighters who think that they're pretty good boxers, but he can show them that they can't lay a finger on him. The fighter-turned-coach is played by Klaus Maria Brandauer, the great, and I really do mean great, Austrian actor. Here he talks with another Russian now living in America.
This is America, yes,
yeah,
not Russia.
Uh-huh.
You cannot be the man you were there.
I cannot be the man I was. No, I can't. I took my name and I took my passport. Here I'm. Dishwasher. Drunk. Parasite. Bum. I insult my friends in front of the real Americans.
Brandauer's an exciting, unpredictable actor. He was Sean Connery's adversary in Connery's last James Bond film, Never Say Never Again, and Brandauer also starred as Meryl Streep's husband in Out of Africa, where I think he was even better than Robert Redford. He is marvelous. There are predictable scenes in Streets of Gold, and only Brandauer's acting ability managed to inject those scenes with just a little bit of interest, as in this training sequence.
Are getting better and better now. No more cupcakes. Golden hands, Timmy. You could have golden hands. And now, the head. We plan everything, every second, every move, every round. We plan ahead of time. Think all the way through. All the way through. East.
I think you have to be a Klaus Maria Brandauer nut to enjoy Streets of Gold at all. And I am such a fan of his that I did appreciate his work. But recommend the film? Never. This is tired material, just another son of Rocky and the Karate Kid. And what's missing is more scenes of Brandauer and possibly his adjustment to America. Only that could have saved what is otherwise a mediocre sports film.
This time, I'm in total agreement with you, Gene. I was really disappointed because this character is original. He comes
mm-hmm.
on the screen. We haven't mm-hmm. seen a guy like this
well,
before.
A little
he
bit,
has problems.
A little bit Moscow on the Hudson with Robin Williams. A little bit.
I think totally different because this guy is an alcoholic and he has mm-hmm. totally lost everything.
Okay.
He's sleeping on the beach. He's crawling around in the gutter. He's
yeah.
going to try to find not only what it means to be an American, but what it means to be sober, what it means to find out what he lost when they threw him off that team 10
right.
years ago. That is interesting. To me, the drama in this film is inside that character.
Well, that's what I, right.
And when they go on automatic pilot with the Rocky ripoff, at
it.
That point, I lost my interest.
Yeah.
Klaus Maria Brandauer is not even at the center of the movie anymore.
Yes.
He's standing on the side, cheering for his guys in the ring.
Right.
And it's just another cliche ending, another boxing
picture. Here's what happened. An American film company takes a great European actor,
mm-hmm.
and they stick him in a movie that is not They want him, but they don't want to make a movie about him because
right.
they think that they got to make it for the teen market, so he
That's
has
right.
him running teenagers.
Sooner or later, people are going to have to get tired of these formulas. You know what Irwin Winkler said, the man who produced the original Rocky? He said, more money has been lost imitating Rocky than Rocky ever made. And here's another bushel basket full. When we come back, we're going to take another look at one of the most amazing box office hits of the year. We're going to ask the question, why do people like Crocodile Dundee so much?
He's a mighty hunter named Mick Dundee. They can dance like Fred Astaire.
One of the most surprising success stories at the American box office this year has been the sensational popularity of a movie named Crocodile Dundee, a comedy about a wilderness guide from the outback of Australia and his adventures after he visits New York to see the woman that he loves. This is a movie that a lot of American distributors turned down. They thought American audiences would be turned off by the Australian accent and the Australian slang. But in the 2 months since it opened, Crocodile Dundee has been at the top of the national box office listings for 7 straight weeks. It has grossed $68 million. It has improved every week, another 12% last week, and has made a major star out of a laid-back Australian TV actor named Paul Hogan. Here he is making himself right at home in the big city.
Mick Dundee from Australia. How are you?
I'm fine. How are you?
I think we're familiar with
this guy.
This guy
been down for a couple of days. Probably see you around.
Paul Hogan was not a Hollywood star when Crocodile Dundee opened, but he was known to a lot of American TV viewers because of his role as a spokesman for Australia on TV commercials. Here he projects a certain rough-edged, down-home charm.
No worries. You'll have the time of your life in Australia. Of course, we talk the same language. Although you lot do have a funny accent.
I guess at work they say there are twice as many American visitors in Australia this year as last year. Crocodile Dundee, meanwhile, is such a big hit that Hollywood executives are trying to figure out the formula so they can rip it off. And I can only imagine what lousy Australian actors we're going to see now visiting Chicago and Los Angeles right about next spring, I think. My notion is American audiences like Crocodile Dundee for two reasons. One, because Paul Hogan himself is an immensely appealing actor with a sort of Jimmy Stewart combination of authority and modesty. And two, we're fascinated by this portrait of American society from the point of view of an outsider, a tough, no-nonsense outsider who's nevertheless never cruel, never bitter, but cuts through all of the anger and violence of a big city with his cheerful, good-natured charm. This is a truly escapist movie in which we are invited to identify with a man who can live life on his own terms and still be a nice guy.
Sort of a likable Dirty Harry, if you will.
Yeah.
I think that there's another thing going on which has kicked this into high gear. I think that there's a large audience out there, which Hollywood doesn't realize, which are people over 40 who are looking for what is known as clean entertainment, wholesome entertainment. This was the audience that was tapped into by On Golden Pond, which came out and made it a $100 million hit. And when enough adults, because I'm hearing from adults who don't go to the movies that often, that they're going to see this picture because the word of mouth on this film was built by word of mouth and advanced screenings, not by critics. It was built by that. They're hearing it's fun. It's old-fashioned. You mentioned Jimmy Stewart. It's recalling an old-fashioned, innocent kind of picture.
But you know what the funny thing is? When you talk about it being clean entertainment, if you look at it carefully, it has transvestites in it, prostitutes in it, a gay bar in it. It has muggers in it. So that what it does is it takes the people who are looking for that kind of entertainment and entertains them by showing somebody else who isn't looking for that kind of entertainment and who puts down all of these elements and people that they're afraid of or turned off by, so that vicariously, in a way, they can get titillated and at the same time be reassured of all of these wonderful values that Paul Hogan stands for. It's an interesting, more subtle movie than people might think.
And more successful than anyone expected. Coming up next, Rated X, a film examining pornography in America.
No one is interested in breaking the law or violating any social standard.
Our next film is called Rate It X, a well-intentioned documentary focusing on the sexism debasing women that is involved in everything from national advertising to porno magazines. Oddly enough, the more tame material, the national advertising, is more interesting. For example, there's a terrific scene in which a computer salesman talks about a print ad for one of his computer monitors, which is pictured incongruously on top of a Bentley automobile and is embraced by a buxom blonde.
Showing the Bentley and the lady next to the monitor, we hope, indicates quality product.
How would they do that?
Well, obviously the Bentley is a recognized quality product and the lady sure seems to be.
What indicates that she's a quality product?
Her physical appearance.
What about it?
Seems to be appealing to a lot of potential customers.
How?
I don't understand your question. How is she appealing?
Why did you choose her?
I don't know why the company. We got her from an agency. She was chosen from an agency, possibly by the personal preference of the person that chose her.
Another example of sexism in our products is an automated bank teller, which has been given a woman's name and a little girl's face.
Could you describe the marketing strategy behind the logo? Why, for instance, does she have hearts in her hair?
Well, I think that Jeannie is a nice, attractive-looking little teller that is there to serve you 24 hours a day, as we said. It is a lady, as you can see, as most of our tellers are.
Most of the film, though, is devoted to sexually explicit material, including this visit inside a porno palace. Don't worry, we're not going to show you any nudity.
But what kind of man do you think women like, besides just in bed?
They like a man who's not going to just touch them and be afraid to hurt them. They like a man who's going to be a little aggressive. He's not going to be afraid to squeeze or give them a little slap or something. That they find that exciting.
Now, the scenes involving the porno world, which occupy the bulk of the film, are neither surprising or that well done. We know that's going to be depressing walking into a shop like that, and it is depressing. The interviewing is not particularly probing either. It's an easy and well-deserving target, but the filmmakers here really don't score that often.
It's not a good film. It's not a good documentary, and yet at the same time, I'm giving it a very marginal recommendation because of the intrinsic interest of some of the people in it, which is one reason to go to the movie, just because you're interested in what's happening no matter how badly it might be done. I found that the way that some of those guys tap dance around the issue was fascinating. For example, the black art director defending his Black Skin magazine on the grounds that black women should be equal too, so they should be pinups just like white women.
Yeah.
Now that was interesting. And the guy who draws the Chester the Molester cartoons for Hustler magazine,
yeah,
explaining how this had nothing to do with the fact that he loved his own daughter.
Yeah.
The way that people are able to separate out parts of their minds from the rest of their lives, to me, is the most interesting thing in this film and worth going to see the film for.
Okay, but Roger, I think that those people know exactly what, these are not dumbbells, they know exactly what they're saying on camera, and they're very clever interviews. I thought what was much more interesting is showing the insidious sexism that's involved in little everyday things. We know that what the porno world does.
Yeah.
I didn't know this other stuff. One is familiar, one is a surprise. I vote thumbs down. I didn't think it was an interesting interview.
Okay, well, we're pretty much, I'm just barely over that line. When we come back, we'll look at what's new in the video stores, including Sylvester Stallone in Cobra.
Because as long as we have to play by these rules and the killer doesn't, we're going to lose.
Now it's time for our weekly video segment where we take a look at the new releases in your local video store. And one of the movies getting a big push this week is, in my opinion, one of the most disappointing movies of 1986, Roman Polanski's Pirates. This was a big-budget bomb starring Walter Matthau, who worked hard but never seemed quite convincing as a pirate named Captain Red. Polanski built a real pirate ship for the movie, and here's Matthau trying to come aboard. Matthau is a likable actor, but Pirates doesn't give him anything to do except stand around on his peg leg and snarl cliches. This movie is all production and no story. There wasn't anything I cared about and nothing to cheer for.
It's an awful film, and in fact, it was out of the theater so fast. What I'm afraid of is people see it in the video store and they say, Pirates, Walter Matthau,
Roman Polanski,
those are three, you know, active ingredients. It's got to be good. It's not good. It's awful. There's no story. It's just that dumb slapstick with a rope, and you know it's going
to
break.
It gives a bad name to pirate movies.
Right. See Captain Blood instead. Also new on the video shelves this week is Sylvester Stallone's Dirty Harry imitation Cobra, which had a terrific opening scene. Stallone is a Dirty Harry type cop, blew away a creep in a supermarket, but then the film ran downhill with endless chases that show you 50 ways to leave your motorcycle. A lot of of noise, but it's boring, very boring. And that's a shame because this film started out like a powerhouse, and then I think the audience sensed that Stallone really didn't have anything to say in this film that Clint Eastwood and his company, the director Don Siegel, didn't say better 15 years earlier in Dirty Harry.
One of the things that's disappointing about Stallone is that he really hasn't realized that potential that he showed in his early pictures to be an actor who was able to combine tenderness and humor and a real screen presence with violence. Here, he could just as well be some animated hero on some Saturday morning kiddie show for all of the depth that he has.
No depth at all, just a lot of firepower. Now let's take another look at the movies we reviewed this week. We had a split decision on The Mosquito Coast, the epic adventure with Harrison Ford leading his family into the rainforest. Rogers said that Ford's insanity kept him from connecting with his character, but I thought it was a compelling story, beautifully told and acted. We both thought Streets of Gold was a waste of the great actor Klaus Maria Brandauer and a Rocky ripoff, Two Thumbs Down. And we split on Rated X. I thought it was a bad film on a very important subject, pornography. Roger found it interesting enough to give a marginal thumbs up.
So,
I would say see Mosquito Coast.
I would say if this bad, see Mosquito Coast too. I'd have to say that. It's interesting if flawed. That's it
for
this week.
You're giving thumbs down to that one.
I'm giving thumbs down to it, yes.
Yeah,
you want to talk some more about it?
Thumbs up to Rated X. That's what confused me.
You don't understand. You don't understand that these things exist in a continuum where one fails at a different level than the other succeeds. I'll explain it to you after the show is over. That's it for
and
this week.
And the rest of the audience,
next
too.
Time we'll be back with reviews of four new movies, including Star Trek IV, The Voyage Home. And we'll also look at Chuck Norris's latest adventure, Firewalker. That's next week. And until then, the balcony is closed.